Baruchim Abayim, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Beth Gavriel Community Center, where tonight Chazaq is proud to present world-renowned lecturer and author Rabbi Hanoch Teller. Before we begin tonight's inspiring event, we want to start off with a very, very important thank you. Hakarat Tov to my very good friend, Mr. Efraim Ashkabov, who initiated this entire event. Chazaq Baruch Efraim. Efraim and his wife, Yafa, God bless them. They're always initiating different projects and programs and events. We really appreciate that. We need more Efraims in this community, more people to step up to the plate and make more chizuk and inspiration in the community. Tonight's event is dedicated for the refuah shlema of a very dear community member, Nisan ben Liza and Luba bat Osnat. Hashem yishlach lehem refuah shlema b'meira. Amen. All the divrei Torah, all the chizuk, all the inspiration will be for their speedy recovery. Le'avdid also, tonight's event is also dedicated in loving memory of Osnat bat Avigal Roach Hashem Tenechei B'Gan Eden. Amen. I want to thank Hiski and Avi. God bless you guys. Chazak Baruch for sponsoring the event. Bezat Hashem, you should only hear Besorot Tovot. And good news only. Amen. Morar Rabotai, upcoming events and programs. Every night there's a men's learning program over here at the Beth Gavriel Center, Sundays to Thursdays, 8:30 to 10 p.m. Classes in Hebrew, English, and Russian. V'higita bo yomam v'layla. We know the importance of learning Torah every single day. So we encourage all the guys to come, check it out. Come get inspired. There's various different topics, Musar, Halacha, Gemara, Mishnah, whatever you want. We're going to be continuing having one-on-one learning programs, Chavruta programs, whoever is interested in that. We're going to be doing that, the special program from Yeshiva Bachim from Baltimore coming special for that throughout the summer. Whoever is interested in a chavruta, please come and see us. Let us know. For the ladies, we will be resuming our Monday night classes over here in Far East Hills. We had it for a while in Kew Garden Hills. It went very, very well. We're going to be bringing it back to popular demand over here in Far East Hills. Tuesday night, we're going to be having a special women's event with Rebbetzin Orit Esther Ryder, who is the author of Daily Dotes of Emunah. The topic is Turn Around Your Life with Emunah. All ladies are encouraged to come Tuesday night, July 14th, at the Young Israel of Kew Garden Hills. That's in Flushing. So you'll see flyers all around the community regarding that event. A week from tonight, we're going to be having a Chazak event with Rabbi Shmuel Yaakov Klein on the Holocaust in the 3 weeks. That's going to be right over here as well. And 2 weeks from tonight, we will be all morning, we'll all be celebrating the Eretz Yisrael, but if for whatever reason Mashiach doesn't come, we will be having our yearly annual Tisha B'Av marathon, starting with Motzei Shabbat, which is Saturday night. We're going to be having Rabbi Yaakov Menashe, who's going to be speaking on the passing of his wife, Rabbi Ruth Menashe. It's going to be right over here at 10:30 p.m., followed by Sunday from morning to night. Inspirational speakers including Rabbi Ben Zion Schaefer, Rabbi Ben Zion Klatsko, Rabbi Pesach Kron, Rabbi Ilan Mer, Rabbi Zohar Yitzchakov, etc., the entire day. So please save the date, and you'll definitely be notified about that event as well. Our last announcement regarding events is that September 9th, save the date, Chazak's third annual dinner, Rabbi Zat Hashem and Terrace in the Park. Baruch Hashem, the first year we had 600 guests, the second year we had 750 guests. This year, our dream is to have 1,000 people to come, show support for this organization so we can do much more in this community. Aside from all these events and lectures that we organize almost on a daily basis, we have obviously the teens division, which is kids from local public schools. We have the radio program, the parsha papers in Hebrew, English, and Russian, the magazine, and the CD distribution, and the libraries, and I could go on and on about the different programs. But Baruch Hashem, the organization is flourishing. We're doing as much as we can, but we're never satisfied. We've got to do more. Until Baruch Hashem Mashiach will be here. Without further ado, it is our honor and privilege and pleasure to host right over here in our community the world-renowned lecturer, author, filmmaker, and storyteller. Let's give a nice, loud round of applause to Rav Hanoch Teller, please.
Thank you very much. After this introduction, I even want to hear what I have to say. Yes. If I may correct you, Yaniv, we need more Ephraims in the world, not just for Chazak. What a blessed person he is. Okay, thank you, Yaniv, and all the Chazak team. It's an incredible credit that in the middle of the summer we have a beautiful crowd. And kol hakavod. I want to stress, even though you already said, I'm going to say it again, they deserve it. Tonight, as you know, is a refuah shleima for Nisim ben Liza and Luba bat Asnat, and it's also in memory of Asnat bat Abigail. Thank you to those sponsors. Chazaq made one mistake. He didn't ask me what I'm speaking about. and I'm still thinking. But it's not a popular subject. We want to talk about, we are in the 3 weeks, and this requires a perspective, reflection, sobriety, which I wish to address. Remember when we were kids, I'm 27, but when we were kids, there was a magazine, I don't even know if it's still around. It was always in school we had it, and it was in dentist office, highlights. In the back of it, it said, what's wrong with this picture? It's still around? Okay, we saw the pictures. What's wrong with this picture? And so I'm not proud of doing this in public, because I don't like to talk about shtick, certainly not in public and wheeling and dealing, but I live in Israel, I travel to America often, and I was flying back to Israel, and my kids called me up and they said they want to buy a stroller for my daughter, for my daughter's children, for my daughter as a gift. My kids, did you get that? Okay. They wanted to buy a stroller. I mean, I'm 27, but she's 35. So for her children, and they asked me if I would take it, but I was all packed up, and nowadays you can only take one suitcase. And again, I'm not proud of this, but what I did was, I checked in the suitcase, and then I went to the gate of the plane, like any other toddler-toting parent, and checked in the stroller. And then when I landed in Tel Aviv, again, I picked up the stroller, and I'm waiting at passport control, and the fellow next to me said, there's something wrong with this picture. You're missing something. And we all travel, we all know that terror of passport, wallet. And I said, passport, check. And the laptop was over my shoulder, check. And I had the carry-on, check. No, I think it's okay. He said, you have a stroller without a baby. And that's, I'm just using it as a mashal, is that we think everything is fine and good, and Baruch Hashem, we have all these shiurim, but there's something wrong with the picture. And that's, we're missing the temple. And that's a very significant issue. I'm going to tell you a story which is a true story. When I say a true story, I mean it's not an email that went around. It actually happened. My friend, Yussel Chapnick, he lives in Borough Park. And one day, he had a black painter painting his apartment. They're taking all the paintings off the wall. That would have been rather ironic, not ironic, moronic, to leave them on the wall. And they're taking the pictures off the wall, and one of the enlargements is a blow-up of the Bub of a Rebbe. And the black painter said to Yussel, is this your rabbi? He said, no. So he said to him, why isn't he your rabbi? He's not my rabbi, let's get on with the job. But why isn't he your rabbi? He's not my rabbi, let's get on with the job. But why isn't he your rabbi? He's not my rabbi, can we get on with the cotton picking? But why isn't he your rabbi? Look, there's so many rabbis there, beard, peyot, they're very rabbinic looking. Let's get on with the job. But why isn't he? He's not my rabbi. And then the black painter said, he's my rabbi. What the? And he pulls out his wallet and rips out a photograph of the Bubba Varebi. He said, what? He said, I'll tell you. He said, one morning I was painting the house, and the Rebbe came home and he said to me, did you have breakfast? I said, no. He said, sit down. He waited upon me, and then he said to me, I want to tell you something. And I knew just what he was going to say. I heard this spiel a million times. He's going to tell me I'm paying you good money. I want a perfect job. And the Rebbe said, we once had the world of perfection. And everything was the way it's supposed to be. We had the Beit HaMikdash. But because of our sins, the temple was destroyed. And ever since, we've never had that world of perfection. So I cannot ask you to do a perfect job, but I'd like you to try your hardest. And you know what his people recommend? He gave me hundreds of his chassidim. No one ever offered me breakfast, but they all say to me, I'm paying you good money. I want the perfect job. And I say to them, you want a perfect job? There's no temple. How do you want a perfect job? But that's the perfection that we're supposed to be striving for. And I want to try and explain this to you. There is a mashal, maybe you heard it. There was an artist, a very talented artist, but he felt in the hustle and bustle of the city, he couldn't yet achieve his greatest achievement, the magnum opus. But perhaps in the mountains, in the quiet, bucolic, lyrical atmosphere with the bird chirping, and the aroma of the flowers, there he could create his greatest creation. So he took his pigment, and his easel and paint and the brush strokes, and he climbed up to the top of the mountain. He set up the easel, and every day, deliberate fine strokes, and day after day after day, it was unbelievable. Something which he never thought he could achieve, it came out even better than that. And when he finished, he was amazed, agog, slackjawed, a twitter, at how beautiful it was. And he took a step back, because from the distance he was more attractive. And another step, and another step, and he was just totally intoxicated, mesmerized by the beauty of his creation. Unbeknownst to him, he was about to fall off the cliff. Coming up the other side of the mountain was a mountain climber, and at once he took in the whole scene, how the fellow was backing off, he said, "Hello, hello, hello, hello!" Another step, another step. And he didn't know what to do, and he's screaming and shouting, and the fellow was just mesmerized by the beauty of the painting. Seeing no other recourse, this mountain climber took out a blade, went to the easel, and cut the painting into shreds. "What have you done? My masterpiece, you've destroyed it." He said, "Look where you were, about to plunge to the depths." Navi after Navi excoriated our people until finally there was no other recourse, but God had to destroy the bayit. We should wake up and realize how far, how close we were to plunging into the depths. Is this not what Yeshaya Navi said? "Lam li rov zivchechem amar Hashem, I've really had enough of all your sacrifices. I'm nauseated by it. Who asked you for it? I find them despicable. Kitarbu tefillah and neni shomea. All your tefillot, they no longer have meaning to me. Spare me. I had enough of it already." And more contemporaneously, Harav Yisrael Salanter, who in my opinion is about as close as we can get to a Navi, he said the same thing. "You're leading lives, and you're so concerned about ben adam lamakom, and you forgot the mitzvot ben adam lachavero. To have a moral sensitive life and care about other people. And you want so many chumrot, and you're not thinking about your fellow person." I'll give you an example or two or three. When you wash your hands for bread, and here, if nothing else, you'll walk away with halacha. I have guests, and I watch, they pour water over their fingertips. You should pour the water over the entire hand up until the joint, twice in the right hand, and twice on the left hand. And the Talmud teaches us, the more water you pour, the greater the blessing. And people that are very pious are pouring buckets and buckets and buckets and buckets. And he was pouring, he was at a wedding, and he poured just. He did not waste not a drop, not half a drop. He said, whoa, what are you being so sparing for? And he said, it's not like today where there's a tap and a faucet. There's a water schlepper who's going to carry the buckets of water. I'm going to be machmir on his cheshbon? Oh no, that violates doctrine. A guy put on his talit in Beit Knesset, and he whipped 14 people in the radius. Who needs the talit? Philip got up early. You know, you're not so far away from the slichot. So he wants to get up early for slichot. He gets up early, wakes up his wife, makes himself a coffee, slops up the kitchen, runs out, slams the door, wakes up the kids. Who needs the slichot? It's not worth it. It's very worth it, but not on someone else's cheshbon. And he said, and you have to have these words engraved on your bathroom mirror, that your face is reshut harabim, your face is public domain, and your heart is reshut hayachid, private domain. And there's a fellow, one of his talmidim, Rav Yisrael Salanter, was walking around Elul. Pardon me, I said to you, he said, "You can't do this. You're walking around like a sourpuss. No one knows why you have such an upset face. And they'll think it's because of them. Your face is public domain." Now, it's pithy to say this. I actually saw this. I'll give you one example. Rav David Hechsher, Zichron Livracha, was a Rosh Yeshiva in Kol Torah in Israel. The last 3 years of his life, he was in America with a terrible disease, lo aleinu. And I took my twin daughters to him for bracha before their bat mitzvah, 2 days before he passed away. Mount Sinai Hospital, among the other cancers, he also had cancer of the liver, which meant he was entirely yellow. He had one whisker left on his chin. He was a bag of bones, gasping for each breath. And I came in with the girls. He had a smile from here to China. And I can't begin to fathom his suffering. But he was going to foist his suffering on my daughters. your face is Rishut HaRabim. And he said, Rishut Salanter, he said, the other person's Gashmiut is my Ruchniut. Think about that. Most people think about it the other way around. I'm not concerned about the length of your skirt, the length of your tzitzit, and what's in your pot. I'm worried about, do you have a place to eat and do you have a place to sleep? And that Gashmiut brings to Ruchniut. Now think about this. I don't know about Queens. I don't even know much about America. I travel here often, but fundamentally I'm an Israeli. But in Israel, not far from where I live, there's shtibalach. And these shtibalach, they're making minyanim all the time. The fellow standing on the corner asking, did you daven yet? He's trying to make a minyan. In my mind's eye, I picture Rishon Salanter asking, did you sleep yet? Did you eat yet? And that focus, that brings to Ruchniut. But otherwise, I've had enough. Spare me all the religiosity if you're not concerned about the fellow person. Okay. Now, we're duty-bound to think about the Chorban and what we're missing. Now, most people find the idea of the Beit HaMikdash so foreign that thinking about we're missing something sounds bizarre and peculiar and weird and strange. It's not a new phenomenon. At the turn of the century, and I don't mean 15 years ago, there was a great Talmid Chacham in America called, his initials were the Ridvaz. He was a rabbi in Chicago, and there was a position which opened up in New York, and he asked him if he would take the position. And all his life he wanted to travel to Israel, and he's most famous for at the end of his life he lived in Tzfat, and he wrote his famous commentary on the Yerushalmi when he lived in Tzfat. And he figured that geographically New York is on its way to Israel. He took the position, and no sooner had he arrived, and the Kishinev pogrom erupted. For those who are not familiar, the Kishinev pogrom was the big daddy of all the pogroms. So nefarious, pernicious, Machiavellian, diabolic, sinister, and iniquitous that the American government and the French government and many others curtailed all relations with the Russian Empire because of how many Jews were murdered and left homeless in the Kishinev pogrom. And the Jews in New York, those of you not familiar, Kishinev is a city in Moldova. There are Jews from Moldova, and they wanted to do something to raise money on behalf of their brethren. They didn't have exactly Torah leadership, and they hit upon the following idea. They're going to sponsor a ball, a dance, men and women dancing, and the proceeds they'll give to the Jews of Kishinev. However, the custom was in those days, whenever you had a Jewish event, quote Jewish, meaning even if just the subject was somehow connected for Jews, the custom was to invite the Rav. How in the world are you going to invite the rabbi to an event of dancing, meidlach, freilach? And it was Saturday night was the event, and they hit upon the following idea. Friday afternoon, right before Shabbat, they'd stick the invitation under his door, and technically they will have invited him, but they knew it would be too late to change his plans to arrive. And sure enough, Motzei Shabbat, they had the bull, and everyone's dancing, and freilach, and there's a grandstand, and music, and food. And at 5 to 12, the Ridvaz walks in, a Jew with a long beard, long coat, bulletproof stockings, goes over to the grandstand, quiet, I wish to speak. Everyone is frozen. I want to tell you a story. And he related that there was a farmer who lived out in the sticks, and he wanted to raise his children as proper Jews, but there's no schools over there. So he hired a melamed, or we call it a melamed. And this melamed, he had many of them, but this one was very, very gifted and talented. He had a special way. But there was one thing about him that was very bizarre. Every night, he would get up at 5 to 12, sit down on the floor, lower his hat over his eyebrows, take off his shoes, and sit on the floor and mourn. And one day I mustered the courage to tell me, Rabbi, what are you doing? He said, the temple is destroyed. And we mourn its destruction, and we pray for its rebuilding, and therefore we say, Tikkun Chatzot. And that's what I'm doing. The farmer said, wow, I never heard of this. Can I do this also? We don't get any mitzvot over here. Sure, what do? Just wake me up at 5 to 12. He woke him up, he said, okay, now, I want you to focus. We long to have the temple rebuilt, and you have to really want it for it to happen. And the farmer said, but wow, a new mitzvah. We never get into mitzvah. Let's drink a l'chaim. No. That is not appropriate. Let's drink a l'chaim. Come on, a little schnapps. No. Okay, l'chaim. Okay, now, think about it. The temple is destroyed. We want to rebuild. You know what? Come on, a celebration like this, a new mitzvah. When do we ever get a new mitzvah? Come on, another l'chaim. No, okay. At 2:45, the farmer's wife woke up, and she found the melamed and the farmer dancing in the kitchen. The temple destroyed, l'chaim, 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 the temple's destroyed. Said the Ritvaz, Kishinev is destroyed, l'chaim, and he stomped out. We have to have a sense of what is appropriate and to really mourn of something that we're missing. Now, most speakers focus on the Bayit Sheni because we can much more identify with its cause of destruction, which was sinat chinam, baseless hatred. And that's, I think, for two reasons. The first temple was destroyed because of gilui arayot, shichut damim, and avodah zarah. Because of murder, illicit sexual crimes, and idolatry. Two reasons, I think, why people don't speak about this. One is because, thank God, these three cardinal crimes do not plague our community. Secondly, if someone were to commit these crimes, murder, sexual crimes, idolatry, it wouldn't take a rocket scientist to realize you must do tshuva. This is a pretty heinous, severe crime. But there isn't that overwhelming sense that if I have baseless hatred, ay, 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 I forgot to help the lady down the street. I didn't smile to the old gentleman. You don't have the sense, oh, I did something terrible. And therefore, we have to, that's why most speakers speak about this. It doesn't, I'll give an analogy. If we don't focus on the loss of Bayit Rishon and what we lost and what we're missing, you tell a swinging bachelor, you know, you need to get married. I said, yeah, I thought about it upon rare occasion. But you tell a person who had a loving wife who is now a widower, and you tell him he's got to get married, he doesn't need any reminder. He knows what it was, and he misses it. He was there. I'll give you one more analogy. You are looking to buy a home, and you have the home of your dreams in your mind, and the real estate agent takes you to this beautiful colonial with a manicured garden, and you're picturing, you know, the smokestack, the chimney with the smell of apple pie and chocolate chip cookies coming out, and a carpet that's so plush you'll have enough static electricity to generate Niagara Falls. And there's probably one staircase just going up and another staircase going down with an oak banister. And the real estate agent takes you to the back of the house. And there's a tomato patch, and there's flowers and petunias and hyacinths. And he said, but let's go into it. I want to see this house. I got to see the house. I want to see the living room. This. And she keeps, and then in the back of the property, there's this shed with a rusty door, no plumbing, no electricity. And she says, here. I'm claustrophobic. I got a family. I can't put my family. I don't want to buy this. She said, hey, you know, you got a roof over the head. You're not sleeping under the stars. If you know what the colonial is, who's going to want to live in a shed? If we know what happened in Bayit Rishon and all the glory that God provided for us, how can we be satisfied with what we have today? We're missing the most fundamental thing. And this is not an exhaustive list. But a few things I thought about. In the time of the Beit HaMikdash, all the miracles were manifest. Every day, for everyone to see, Jew and non-Jew. You could watch the fire, descend in Mina Shamayim as it would consume the korbanot. The Mizbeach, the altar, was in the Azara, open for everyone. If it rained in Yerushalayim, it rained everywhere but except for in the Makom HaMikdash. There was no fire, there was no rain there. And if you had a matter of serious nature, you could go to the Kohen Gadol, to the high priest, and ask him a question, and his Urim V'Tumah would light up with a response. If you followed it, you had very good direction. If you ignored it, the consequences were catastrophic. They would take the intestines of a korban, of a sacrifice, throw it onto the floor, and it was absorbed into the floor. And that's a grade B miracle. This didn't make it into the hit list of Pirkei Avot. That's a grade B miracle. One miracle after another. As long as there was Bayit Rishon, there was a Navi, there was a prophet. Yechezkel, Yirmiyahu Navi, and no one could deny that there was a God. It was manifest to all. That epoch, when we had Klal Yisrael at its very optimum, was very short. It was the time of Shlomo HaMelech. It's about 3,000 years now since Kabbalat HaTorah. And the time that we had our optimum in the time of Shlomo HaMelech, that was about 500 years, historically a blink of the eye. So therefore, when we say we want Mashiach, that means we want to have the period that's like when Shlomo HaMelech was the king, and we had all of our 10 tribes which are lost together with all of us. You can't be happy. It's like that real estate agent. You can't be happy with the shed if you thought you're going to get the colonial. If we know that we could have the entire nation together, all focused where everything is manifest at the hand of God, how can we be satisfied with bargain basement that we have today? It's a matter of perspective. I'll give you an analogy of what I mean by perspective. Rashi says this very briefly, Tanchuma enlarges upon it. When Avram Avinu went to Akedah, to the binding, it was a party of how many? There's a machloket here. Actually, it was 4+. Right? It was Avraham, Yitzchak, Avraham and his son Yitzchak, Eliezer, Yishmael, correct, the two lads. And if the donkey made it into Torah, we should mention the donkey as well. So Tanchuma elaborates, and it was in the third day, and they saw the mountain from afar, the mountain of Har Moriah, where Yitzchak will be sacrificed. And the Medrash says, Avram looked down and said, my son, do you see what I said? Yes, my father, I see it. He then turned to Eliezer Yishmael, do you see it? And they said, no. How can it be that two people could look at the same thing and not see the same thing? I'll give you a mashal. I'll give you an analogy. You walk into a physics lab, and there you have a Wilson cloud chamber, which is a smoky box of glass where electrons are shot through. I ask you, what's this? You tell me it's a smoky box of glass. I'm a physicist, so I know it's a Wilson cloud chamber. We both see the same thing, yet we perceive different things. Well, I'll sing a little tune for you. Na 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 na. So what am I singing? She thinks it's a little melody, at best. And I think it's Schubert's Unfinished Symphony. We both heard the same thing, yet we perceived different things. And it was in the third day. And Avram looked down and said, my son, do you see what I said? Yes, my father. For he perceived that those clouds on top of the mountain, that was the Shekhinah HaKadosha, that was God's holy presence. Eliezer Shmuel, do you see it? They saw scenery. You don't see, you stay here at the donkey. He's myopic, you're myopic, you stay here, and we shall continue. And that's always the way it is. A carpenter comes in the room, he notices the carpentry work. An electrician comes in, notices the electrical work. A CIA agent comes in, he notices a bug. I also see a bug. I mean the electronic listening device. I can tell you a story. This story I used to tell, it was very popular when I used to tell it, and it was so popular that everybody, a lot of my stories are plagiarized, but this one, if I would tell people, thought I was telling someone else's story, but it happened to us, to me, to us. We were wed in Israel, and after our wedding, we traveled, I'm originally from Vienna, we traveled to Vienna, and then in Vienna, we were gonna continue back onto America. We get to Vienna, and I had this idea, why don't we go to Czechoslovakia, just 100 kilometers away. Now, even though I'm 27, this was, I'm old enough that the Iron Curtain was still up. So we get to Prague, and all of a sudden we walk into this hotel of sorts. It hits me that the room has to be bugged, right? There must be a listening device. And I don't know what I'm looking for, but I'm looking for it. And we're newlyweds, my wife is not into my shtick. So looking and looking and looking, and I can't find it, and I'm about to abandon the search. And then, aha, I notice right there in the front of the room, there's a bump on the floor, which arouses my suspicion. I lift up the area rug, and there's a little nut which arouses my suspicion, which I unscrew and I inspect. It appears to be innocent enough. About 4 minutes later, there's a very vigorous knock on the door from the woman in the room directly below us, with part of a chandelier embedded in her head. Now, I don't speak Czech, but I think the drift of what she was saying was, don't look for any more chandeliers, right? Not anymore, don't speak any, don't look for any more bugs. You need a perspective. And I submit to you, That's, I think, our greatest problem today, a recognition of God's presence. In the time of the Bayit, when the temple existed, you could not be oblivious to the presence of God. Now, with your kind permission, I'm going to go off script. Because, you know, sometimes they say that through the fruit, you better understand the seed. And that's why speakers speak a lot about the Holocaust in these 3 weeks. And we have a new book, which, when I say it's new, the glue is still wet. And I don't know if the boat docked last week, so I don't know if it's in the shops or not, but we have it here, hint, hint. I want to tell you something. When I grew up, again, I'm 27, but when I grew up, you saw the numbers everywhere. I wonder how many of the numbers of my children have seen, if my grandchildren have seen any. I'm going to tell you a story or two. Erev Yom Kippur is the most crowded day in the men mikveh. SRO, squeeze room only. And in my neighborhood in Jerusalem, which is a pretty devout neighborhood, the mikveh is so crowded Erev Yom Kippur, and is so boisterous and noisy, every wishing gut yantif, gut yar. And there was one kid, and it's all Hasidim and Yerushalmim, all and yeah. I cannot tell you the story delicately because in the mikveh there's no way to conceal because everything is revealed. And everyone's on top of each other and loudly wishing everybody good yom. And there's one kid from across the street from the Or Sameach Yeshiva for beginners. How do I know he's from Or Sameach? It said on his t-shirt, Or Sameach Wrestling. I'm just joking. He had an earring and a ponytail. Clearly he was not a Hasid nor a Yerushalmi. And it was very apparent that this kid felt very much out of place. And he put his palms over his biceps, very apparent to me and to others, that he had a tattoo that was not appropriate for Erev Yom Kippur. I dare say not appropriate for a Gansur or Freilich, but certainly not the eve of Yom Kippur. And the people in this mikveh are not especially subtle, about as subtle as heavy metal is subtle, and they're gawking and gaping this poor kid who's highly embarrassed. He's about to step into the pool, and then he slips and trips and grabs the rail, and there's this roaring silence in the mikveh. Sphinx-like silence. Picture a forest after trees felled. Imagine the Mudville Stadium after Mighty Casey struck out. No one is moving. And these lewd and gaudy tattoos are flying through the air. These were not anchors. These were, we'll leave it at lewd and gaudy, but it was nothing ever. I was going to say Erev Yom Kippur any day of the week, of the year. How inappropriate. In my life, I have never, ever, ever witnessed so much embarrassment. The kid froze. Before it was so noisy, and now you could hear heartbeats. It's as if we went deaf. He froze, everyone froze. He turned alabaster. He died 1,000 deaths, and so I'm cogitating he'll jump in, and he'll never come out. No one was moving. And then an elderly neighbor of mine walked across the moist marble floor. The story happened 19 years ago, and I can still hear in my ears the thwack, 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 as he walks across the moist marble floor and says to this kid who's more dead than alive in his heavily Yiddishy European accent in English, "Don't worry, young man. I also have a tattoo." Points at the numbers going up his arm. In other words, I went through my Gehenom, and you went to your Gehenom. Let's begin Yom Kippur together. Spontaneously, everyone over wished him a Shana Tova. So one small thing can make all the difference in the world. Another story. I have a friend, I should say really an acquaintance of an acquaintance, Dr. Ike Hirschkopf, a psychiatrist in Manhattan. He wrote a book entitled, a book on depression titled Hello Darkness, My Old Friend. Dr. Ike Hirschkopf grew up in Washington Heights in the 50s. And he too grew up with numbers everywhere in the Breuer's community. In the summer, everybody would go to the Rockaways, and he saw numbers. When he was 8 years old, he asked his mother, "When am I going to get my number?" And she ran out of the kitchen crying. Dr. Hirschkopf's uncle was a physician in the Catskill Mountains, people called the country, and his wife was his assistant, his receptionist, and she calls him and she says, "Ike, Rabbi Moshe Feinstein is going to come to the clinic on Sunday. Would you like to meet him?" Now, a kid who grew up in the Breuer's community, to see Moshe Feinstein, you'd give your right arm for this. And he puts on his yantif finery, and he scrubs his face, and he's holding his sefer in the waiting room. He, you know, wants to make the best impression. And Rabbi Feinstein comes in, he'll jump up, he'll hit the roof. And the waiting room gets more and more and more full. and fuller and fuller and fuller and fuller. Finally, Rabbi Feinstein walks in, and his aunt, the receptionist, goes over and says, "Rabbi Feinstein, I'm very, very, very sorry, but we're a lot of people here. You're going to have to wait your turn." And then she plants a kiss on his cheek, and Ike Hirschkopf melts into the floor. When he finally recovers a little bit, he crawls out. He goes over to Rav Moshe in his halting, broken Yiddish. She's not religious. She doesn't know. Rav Moshe says, "Shh. She's got the numbers. She's holier than I." And lastly, the Satmar Rebbe was asked, who should he go to for a blessing? He said, go to Davin. Go pray. We see the men putting on their tefillin. We see the numbers. That is their passport number engraved on their flesh to go to Shemayim. Those are people who can ask for a blessing. In the time that I have, and ironically, no one told me how much time we have, but we're not going to go the full 3 hours, don't worry. I thought 2.5 would be enough. I just want to highlight a few things germane to the Holocaust, because this is the time that it's worthwhile focusing upon it. In 1938, it was a watershed year in destruction of European Jewry, beginning with the Anschluss. In March of 1938, overnight, Austrian Jewry goes under the Nazi heel. And in America, it's a year and a half before the war begins, in America they're concerned about the plight of one Austrian Jew, his suffering and arrest. His name was... Tzvi? There has to be a Tzvi here. No Tzvi. His name was Dr. Sigmund Freud. And the way the mind works, it's just pretty ironic to say talking about Freud, the way the mind works, it's easier to think about one over 250,000. What's the most famous story of the Holocaust? Anne Frank, correct. Now, Anne's story is a very unreflective story, not an emblematic story. She wasn't in the ghettos, wasn't in the camps, she had a roof over her head, she was with her family, there was a modicum of food, but because it's a story, it's easier to relate. I'm a tour guide in Yad Vashem. Yad Vashem is the Holocaust Memorial in Israel. And I'm somewhat amazed that other tour guides unspool statistics and numbers about an infinite crime. I never do that. I tell stories so you can personalize what happened in each and every place. It's easier to relate to Freud over 250,000 Jews. It's easier to relate to Anne Frank over 6 million. It's easier to relate to 6 million paper clips or paper clips over 6 million nefashot. That's the way the mind works. So I'm always trying to stress the individual. So in this book, which we just wrote, Heroic Children, it's a book where no one wants to read about the Holocaust. No one wants to get involved in the squalor or the terror, the killing fields, the murder camps. So what we did was, this was the challenge, to make those not interested, interested. And you can read one book and learn all about the Holocaust. Now, there is no dearth of Holocaust literature because after the war, those who suffered understandably wanted people to know their story and how they suffered. But the children couldn't tell the story then, and they haven't told it since. That's the one frontier which is still available. So what I wanted to do, what I try and do when I give tours, is always highlight the individual. And I'm working on this book no less than 14 years. I'm going to tell you a remarkable story. 14 years I'm working on the book, not consistently. And I neglected, we made a deadline, we had to finish to get it out by the 3 weeks. And I neglected to work on the cover. Whoever thinks that they don't judge a book by its cover, never tried to sell a book. A cover is a very important component. And so I put all my kids, I were looking for all the archives to find a picture. We hit upon what we thought was just the right picture. And the copyright holder is the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, USHMM, in Washington. So I send them an email requesting permission. They say, no problem. You can have the picture in 3 weeks. 3 weeks. You know, life is a roller coaster. I'm desperate. I have to finish. Finally found the picture. 3 weeks. I didn't have 3 days. And then I thought to myself, one second here. To turn a picture from low resolution to high resolution does not require 3 weeks. That's bureaucracy. It takes 10 seconds. And because I'm an Israeli, pardon me, I just started thinking of protexia. What connections do I have? And I thought, I have a friend, very influential, powerful person in Baltimore. They say that in his cell phone, he has every senator and congressman's personal number. Baltimore, how far is that from Washington? I'll bet you he has a connection. And his son learns in yeshiva right next to my house in Jerusalem. So I say, Aryeh, is your father connected with the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum? He said, no. And then he said, my mother is on the board. I was going to wring his neck. So his mother is a judge. And I sent her an email. I said, Chaya, Judge Friedman, I need your help. I need to get a picture instantaneously. So I'll see what I can do. And when you request a picture, you have to write a voucher. You're not going to make any alterations. And I said, I'm going to change this, 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 that, 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 this, that, that, this, this, that, this. And the next day, I had the picture. And again, wow, Baruch Hashem. But one thing I wanted to do, I don't know if you can see from over there, to highlight the individual, I wanted to, this is sepia, to color one boy, one child. Because it's always focusing on the individual. I didn't request that permission. I felt this required explicit permission. So I sent an email again to Judge Friedman. I said, Chaya, I need your permission. I need you to get permission from them. He said, I'm very busy. She said, I'm in the middle of a murder trial. I don't have time. He said, this is killing me. He said, all right. So she sent an email, and she sends me back a correspondence the next day. Yay, yay, nay, nay. It's up to them. I've done what I can. Now that night, we have a printing queue. This thing's 1:30 in the morning. And it's now 3 hours to press. It's 2 hours and 48 minutes to press time. I get an email from the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum from the head archivist saying to me, Dear Rabbi Teller, I'm sorry to tell you, you have no permission. You cannot use it. If you want to use the picture the way it's supposed to be with all the children and not make any alterations, you may. But otherwise, we spoke to our legal department. Unequivocally, they said, you cannot alter. Because this boy that I've highlighted recently spoke out about the picture. He's very sensitive. And the legal department said, you can't change it. You can't use it. What am I going to do? I have now 2 hours and 14 minutes to press time. I've already burned the plates. They're on the drums. In three hours, we're going to have 10,000 covers. What am I going to do? But I don't roll over so easily. A little bit of a fighter. So I sent her back an email. I said, could you please send me his phone number? I'd like to call him. And she said to me, we don't know where he is. We don't know where he lives. I said, right back, but you said that he's sensitive and he spoke out. And she sends me an online clipping. It's now 1 hour and 8 minutes to go to press. Online clipping that this picture was taken upon the liberation of Auschwitz. This year, on the liberation of Auschwitz, 4 people from this picture, now in the grips of very old age, went back to Auschwitz, and they pointed to themselves as youngsters in the picture. And it was apparent from this picture. When I say apparent, it was not explicit. It was perhaps, maybe perhaps, his last name is Hirsch, and it said he lives in Europe. So I'm thinking to myself, Europe. So, well, I figured England, that's not Europe. Russia, that's not Europe. Israel, that's not Europe. Okay, 16 countries to go. And then I said, Monaco, Liechtenstein, yeah, that's not Europe. I got now 14 countries to go. And I'm looking at the picture, and the kid is in pretty, he's in good shape, more or less. Clearly he was not a Pole. A Pole couldn't look like this after 6 years of the war. So I figured he must be a Hungarian. Hungary was invaded March 1944. They were only in the war for a year. Actually, less than a year by the time Auschwitz was liberated. And I figured a Hungarian would never go live in France. Didn't think they'd move to Holland. So in my mind, I'm down to 2 countries, Switzerland and Belgium. And I have a really clever friend who lives in Switzerland. He works for IBM. His name is Moshe Loser. I said, Moshe Loser, I need you to find me a guy named Hirsch who's an Auschwitz survivor. And I hear this raucous laughter. He's doubled over in laughter. And he said, Hanoch, what did you drink? I said, come on, I need it. There's not much time. I got 38 minutes. He said, this is not enough. I work for IBM. Nothing can do that. I said, you know what? He's Hungarian. So I'll bet you his first name is Gavor or Tibor. That's Hungarian, Steve or Mike. So I hear him clicking on the computer. Gavor Hirsch, 86-year-old engineer. Here's his phone number. I spoke to him 11 minutes before press time. He gave me permission. I sent off an email back to the Holocaust Memorial Museum, and I said, I have his permission. If you have any questions, here's his phone number. I want you to know, it would be harder for me to parallel park than to get this fellow's permission. So I took that as an omen for the book. As Americans, we should know there was a lot to do to save our brethren. And there's a take-home message. And the message is the following. I'm sure you've heard of the St. Louis, the most famous or infamous of the doomed ships. On board were 937 Jewish passengers, all of them with legitimate visas to go to Cuba. And it cost them a fortune. They borrowed. To have the money to go to Cuba. As the boat is docked in 1938 in Havana, it's tethered to the port. You can look up and see the passengers, and the Cubans want the bribe. That's not unusual. In Latin America, South America, Central America, a bribe is a way of life. I'll bet you that one of the first words you learn in Spanish is el bribo. So if they want a bribe, what should you do? Yeah, Kim, how do you say in Staples? That was simple. But the leader of American Jewry, his name was Rabbi Stephen S. Wise, whom we used to call Hagoy Hagadol Hazeh. The quintessential reform rabbi, good crop of hair, well-built, stage presence, oratorical abilities, cushy-cushy with FDR, Eleanor, members of the cabinet. Give a bribe. A bribe is against the law. We can't violate the law. And the irony of ironies was, had they required millions, once they were in the country, to be housed and rehabilitated, they would have given the money, but not to violate the law. The captain of the ship, Gustav Schroeder, a German, was a benevolent humanitarian. And of the 937, 736 had legitimate visas for America, but they'd only be valid in 3 months' time. He steams the ship up and down the eastern seaboard, and how does America greet it? With a Coast Guard cutter to intercept. Had they jumped off and swam the 40 miles to Miami, had it been doable, they would have been sent back. And no country gives them haven. They have no recourse to go back to Europe, and they perish. And here, again, we're almost finished. The question is, what could have been done? I don't know if you're familiar with the Musi negotiations, which means you don't read enough Teller books, but more about that later. On the table were arguably the lives of 800,000 Hungarian Jews for $1 million. Now, I'm aware of the fact that $1 million today is not what it was then, but 800,000 lives for $1 million, this would have changed Jewry. This would have been the greatest rescue effort in the history of history, $1 million. Now, the Gedolim of America, the great rabbis, Rabbi Aaron Cutler, Rabbi Lazar Silver, Rom Kalmanovich, Rabbi Yashadar Soloveitchik, they didn't have $1 million, nor did the Vat Hatzalah, not to be confused with the ambulance corps, and important lay leaders like Louis Septimus, Irvin Bunim, Mike Tress, Stephen S. Klein. But the Joint Distribution Committee did have $1 million. So Rav Aaron Cutler goes before the Joint. Now, Rav Aaron Cutler looked old-worldly. He looked like the Lithuanian Rosh Hashiva, short, long black coat, gray, stooped, maybe a tad of dandruff. He didn't look someone who had savvy in political science, as clever as he was. He did not speak English. He conversed in Yiddish. Irving Bunim from Young Israel was his translator. He goes before the Joint and requests $1 million to save Hungarian Jewry. Say, $1 million? That means violating the law. And it was a violation of the law. It means violating the British blockade, which was sacrosanct. It's after Pearl Harbor, it means trading with the enemy, which is a felonious crime. For all I know, it's a treasonous crime. But to the great rabbis of America, it is despicable to violate American law and odious to give money to the Nazis. And yet, there's a higher law, and the higher law is to save a life, pikuach nefesh, pidyon shvuyim, to rescue a captive, aravut, responsibility, one Jew towards his brother. And they will not give $1 million. And Rabbi Cutler pleads and argues and cajoles and wheedles. Finally, they say, okay, we'll give you the money if you get permission from the American government. You get a license from the American government. There's only one person, all of America, who will be authorized to give this license, and that was, of course, the president, named after the highway in Manhattan. So Ravon Cutler, with a raging fever, travels to Washington with Irving Bunim. And apparently FDR felt that the plight of 800,000 Hungarian Jews was not important enough for his time. He sends him to his hyper-assimilated Secretary of the Treasury, Henry Morgenthau Jr. And you can imagine, being a secretary in the FDR cabinet, you have to be an extremely assimilated Jew, which he was. There is no way in the world that Henry Morgenthau Jr. is going to authorize $1 million to give to the Nazis. And again, Ravon Cutler pleads and cajoles and wheedles, but Morgenthau will not give in. Finally, in desperation, Ravon Cutler says to Bunim, "Tell him that you are worthless and Washington is meaningless if you can't save the life of one child in Europe." There is no way in the world that Irving Bunim is going to tell Henry Morgenthau Jr. in the White House that you are worthless and Washington is meaningless. So it gives him a milquetoast version. The rabbi is very disappointed. We hope at one point in the future you can be of help. Now, Ravon Cutler does not understand English, but he was, as I like to joke, an observant Jew. And he sees that what he had said had not, he sees from Henry Morgenthau Jr.'s expression that what he had said had not been accurately translated. Bunim, Zagum Klorb Zachok Zagum, precisely what I told you. Irving Bunim is not going to violate the words of the Gadol Hadar. He looks down at his shoes to see if his laces are tied, socks are pulled up, and other matters of sartorial concern. In a barely audible tone, just a whisper, he says, "Mr. Secretary, the rabbis asked me to inform you that you are worthless. And Washington is meaningless if you can't save the life of one child in Europe." At that point, Henry Morgenthau Jr. collapses on the table like this for what appears to be an eternity at least. When he finally raises his head, his eyes are deltas of red, there's tears cascading down his cheeks. He said, "Tell the rabbi, I've not forgotten who I am. And I've put my neck on the chopping block to save my brethren." And Henry Morgenthau Jr. will go down in history as a man who was willing to sacrifice his career on behalf of his brethren. Ultimately, this plan was scuttled by American Jewry and Swiss Jewry, and Hitler himself intervened. But this tremendous take-home message: we can all do this heroic act because we're going to be remembered by the difficult decisions. One last example, and that is a name you're all familiar with: Oskar Schindler, who was a dishonest businessman, a womanizer, and he saved nearly 1,200 Jews during the Holocaust. Had it not been for the latter, if he'd be remembered, and that's a major if, he'd be remembered as a creep. And now the name Schindler is synonymous with heroism, bravery, courage, self-sacrifice, consideration, synonymous. Like Vaseline means petroleum jelly, and Q-tips means cotton swabs, and Kleenex means tissues, Schindler means self-sacrifice. He changed his name, and we can too, if we make those difficult decisions. We commit ourselves, like my message of tonight, the message of seeing God in the world, which was so much so helpful when we had the temple, that we wish so fervently that it should be restored. Let me conclude by telling you, how do we commemorate those who have perished? The problem is that museums can become mausoleums, literature can become ephemeral gibberish, statues can become shards of pottery. And I don't want to sound too sharp, but without life, death has no future. That's what we say in Hallel, Lo hameti mihalleluka. Without life, death has no future. No seeker of antiquities, no archaeologist, no historian has ever uncovered a memorial of Hananiah ben Trajan, Rabbi Kiva, Rabbi Shmuel, who were all kadoshim, who were all martyrs. There's no tribute or memorial for Kadoshe Beitar, because we have a different way of commemorating. In Majdanek, which is a regional center, not just an extermination camp, there's over 1 million Jews of victims. And I do not know if a still or a video can capture what it's like to see, to smell, to experience 1 million Jews. And every time I've been there, involuntarily, Pavlovian, I put my foot up to one of the shoes and the symbolism hit me. I cannot put my feet into their shoes, but I can try and walk in their path to carry on where they would go. More children performing Torah, learning mitzvot, that would be a fitting tribute. And lastly, I know I ended already, but it's very rabbinic to end several times. In Yad Vashem, there is a memorial called the Children's Memorial for the 1.5 million children under the age of 12 who perished. And thanks to the genius of the architect, you go again. It's as dark and as black as can be. And there's a reflection of a million candles to commemorate the 1.5 million children. And you hear a tape in Yiddish, Hebrew, and English of the names of children who perished. And Rabbi Berlwein pointed out the one name you don't hear is your own name. If you are of Ashkenazic ancestry, the only reason that you are alive is because of a miracle. You, your grandparents, your great-grandparents, and no one thinks that those that were saved were more righteous and pious than those that perished. And I think about this all the time. Moshe Rabbeinu had many beautiful names, Avigdor, Tuvia, Yedidya, and yet, he's always referred to as Moshe. Ki minamayim mishituhu. He always wanted to be remembered that he was drawn forth from the water. He could have been alligator fodder at the bottom of the river, and he had that visage before his eyes that he was saved. We're all survivors. We were saved for a purpose, and that is on behalf of our people. Therefore, I salute Chazaq, all the efforts that we should be involved in what is really what our people is all about. And this time, that's what we have to focus. Our perspective of the 3 weeks, perspective for life, what it means to have the temple restored when Judaism was at its optimum, and we all understood that there's a God who runs the world. If I may just mention, we have finished. Outside, you'll find my books and CDs. I think you'll find them enriching. I know I will. We have a special, the new book, which I'll discuss outside. Thank you, thank you, thank you.